Hello, friends. This is Mike Williams. My colleague and friend, fellow researcher Sallie Witte, discovered something very interesting about Billy Shears, aka Paul McCartney. Something that once you see it, you cannot unsee it. And so without further ado, here's the show with Sallie. Thanks for listening. Well, friends, we have a great show this afternoon. My good friend and colleague, Sallie, is with us today. And Sallie has made what I consider to be a remarkable and groundbreaking discovery with regard to Billy, also known as Paul McCartney. And it's a discovery that once Sallie points it out, once you see it, you cannot unsee it.
We just found something that is going to absolutely blow people's minds, that nobody has discovered this. I honestly think that I was meant to do this. For whatever reason, this affliction that hit me of the millions of people that are quote-unquote Paul McCartney fans, and nobody has spotted this. And maybe part of it is spells. They're so enthralled with the music that they're just not paying attention.
Yeah, I think the other piece of it, Sally, is that a lot of people just don't expect what it is that we're going to talk about.
Yes. Well, if that was not Paul McCartney, I would have known about it. Well, if he had an artificial eye, if he has that, we would know about it. Guess what? Now you've got to find out.
Yes. So what we're going to talk about, folks, is that Billy, a.k.a. Paul McCartney, has an artificial eye. And like I said, we're going to take you through some evidence, and you take a look for yourself. And before we get into that, though, Sally sent me over a little bio. It's a story. And it's a story about Sally and her eye and her journey and how that led her to taking a look into Billy and his artificial eye. And it also will set the table as to why Sallie feels drawn to do the research and to understand him as a person a little better. So with that, Sallie, let me take the audience through your story. And then once I finish it up, anything you want to add that is not included with what you sent me, you can tack on. As a little girl of 7, I sat in a quiet classroom, fidgeting. The other students concentrated intensely on their tests as they hovered low and close to their desks. This was my first day back in a classroom in a long time, and therefore exempt from the testing. After a traumatic surgery and extended recovery time at home, school seemed a welcome break from the constant doctor visits and prosthetic and rehab appointments. My new eye was strange. I couldn't stop touching it until the unforeseeable happened. It fell out. Right upon my open book. It lay there staring at me. Quickly, I snatched it up and looked around the room. All heads were still down. I opened my hand, looked down at my eye, and to my horror, realized not one adult had taught me how to put the imposter back in. After a few fumbling attempts, I stood ever so quietly and silently and made my way to the teacher's desk. I waited for her to notice. She was grading papers and half-heartedly glanced up at me and then went back to her grading. I watched her freeze as the processing of what she had just witnessed took hold. She put both hands across her mouth and she let out a small muffle, then pointed to the door. In the hallway, down the hall, I began to cry. I made her scream. In the bathroom with tears streaming, I couldn't figure out my reflection in the mirror, the socket, and my dexterity while I was sobbing. After what seemed hours, my teacher walked in crying as well. 4 shaking hands dropped the eye time after time, leading to nervous laughter, until we managed to get it back in. We were so happy, we hugged with happy tears. I felt empowered. I had mastered a milestone in my life, the one with the removable eye. I felt as if my fellow students sensed it too. For the rest of the day, the students parted ways to let me pass. In the cafeteria, they kept their distance. It was when I got home and looked in the mirror that I understood the student's reaction. We had put my eye in upside down. I've told that story dozens of times, and it always makes people wince, then laugh. Just as in the hospital, when I made the medical staff laugh and tried to make them feel better when they worked with me. If you make a person laugh, a bond forms, and they become more empathetic and gentler with a needle. When I was 11, I was on my way to another ocularist appointment. For those who don't know, it is the occupation of making artificial eyes. It's an art associated with Freemasons, when their beliefs and traditions were persecuted. They went low and virtually out of sight, save for the eye they hung out of their businesses to alert their brethren of their presence. As my mother drove, it began to snow. It reminded me of a dream I had the night before. In the dream, I found my sweet horse dead under a pile of snow. I told my mom about the dream as we headed toward our appointment. When we made it home, I rushed to check on my horse. My jet pony was dead under a pile of snow. I felt responsible. I was angry. I wanted to remove my eye and crash it against the nearest tree. If I hadn't had to make another one of those visits, maybe I could have saved my horse. Jet was one of the twin horses. The breeder kept his twin, which was a beautiful paint. My Jet was an Appaloosa that seemed to change colors with the seasons. On the other side of the world, a man, quote, born under the astrological sign of Gemini, the twins, wrote a song about his children's pony by the name of Jet. He rode his horse on the farm with his lovely wife and their Appaloosas. He rides an Appaloosa to this day. Years later, I had children of my own. I still remember where I was and what I was doing when I heard the sad news that the man's wife had died. My three sweet children and I bowed our heads and prayed for the man's broken heart. Several years ago, I happened upon a book that, after reading it, changed my entire perspective on reality and how we choose to perceive it. The memoirs of Billy Shears brutally changed the truth of perhaps every narrative known to me. The first time I read the book, it frightened me enough to sleep with the lights on. The third time I spoke of it in Mike Williams' roundtable discussion, I wept when mentioning the chapter on landmines. I couldn't get through it, so Mike had to move to another guest. In a future presentation, Mike and I will discuss the gematria code contained within memoirs concerning the truths of mythology and how it pertains to William. But first, we will show the broken side of William and how he and I share that affliction. The Eye of Ra, the right eye, represents the sun, or the male. The Eye of Horus, which is the left eye, represents the moon, or the feminine. William's right eye was taken, and he could only see with his left. My left eye was taken, and I see with my right. To borrow a reconstructed phrase from Neil Diamond, he is the sun, I am the moon, play me. I can only conclude that to resist the attraction and pull I have towards this man would be futile. Astrologically, it's written in the stars. The man I speak of was born William Shepherd. You know him as Sir Paul McCartney. Now let me show you what I have found. So Sally, is there anything else that you wanted to bring to the audience's attention before we jump into the slides?
Yeah, I thought it was just a few weeks ago that I was listening to an interview with Liam, and he mentioned the whole story about the song Jet, how it started off as a song about his kid's pony, and it just triggered off all these memories of what happened to me, and that can't be by accident that all of this came full circle.
Yeah, there's a lot of connection points between your life experiences and what we're learning about Billy. Yeah, it is very interesting.
And I've always had, you know, a great heart for him and learning about reading memoirs, and I've read it quite a few times. I've always had a real heart for him, but boy, this puts it on a completely different level. It's cathartic for me, if you want to put it that way.
What do you say to people? Because every once in a while when I put the roundtables up and you would mention that you liked Billy, that you have an affinity for him, and sometimes comments will come in and people just go out of their minds. How could you like him? He's a deceiver. He's a liar. How do you address that when people make those comments?
I would just say, put yourself in his shoes. I mean, some of the situations that he was put in and forced to do, I mean, you can't just make a blanket statement without taking into consideration that, did he have a choice in this? I don't think he did. I mean, and I'm convinced that the whole I thing was part of satanic ritual abuse. I think they did this to him.
So this is something that is covered in memoirs. They don't talk about the eye, but memoirs does tell us that he was subjected to ritual abuse starting at the age of 3, if I recall. Is that correct?
Yes.
And in the book, it tells us that some of that abuse was traumatic, very traumatic, and other forms of it were rewarding. That's how trauma-based mind control and programming works, folks. It's not all negative. There's also positive reinforcement.
Let me just say this one other thing, that when they removed my eye for about a week, every time I would open up to look, I would vomit. And it's because when you remove an eye, it tricks the brain. It confuses the brain because now you're not seeing double anymore. You don't have 3D vision, and it results in you having dizziness and all the things that result in it. And, you know, I have nothing but empathy for this man because I've been through what he's been through, or some of it. So, I mean, let's just put that out there.
Yeah, basically blind in one eye.
Yes.
Folks, we were going to cover this as part of a much larger presentation. We were going to talk about Pan and the mythology around Pan. But Sally and I spoke, and we felt that this was too important to just kind of throw in with a larger presentation and make it essentially a subset. We decided not to do that. But with that, Sally, you did do a tremendous amount of work looking into Billy and his connection into mythology, especially as it connects into Pan. And he also connects into Horus and Osiris and all that. But the Pan aspect of it is also extremely intriguing. We're not going to get into that, folks, in this presentation. But what we do want to do is show you a couple of connection points so that we can whet your appetite. Sally, let's move to the slide where you have two images, one of Billy from Driving Rain, and another image on the right of Pan. And, of course, you and I will agree that that's not coincidence.
Yeah, when I first started going into Pan, studying about Pan, and that was all because of Crowley, and Crowley, even at his funeral, had a poem written to Pan. I started looking into it, and there was some things that were descriptions of Pan that I went, well, that sounds a lot like Bill.
Yeah.
And then I came across the picture of Pan jumping over the fence. And I went, that reminds me of something. What is it? And then I went and looked and found the Driving Rain. And it was like, there's no way this is a coincidence. So I knew I was on the right path. I knew I was headed in the right direction with what I was looking into.
Right. And we're going to get more into this. And the one thing, Sally, I know you know this, as we go through this research, and we've been doing it for a long time now, the connection into mythology is undeniable, which tells us that the cultic elite, the controllers, the Illuminati, whatever label you want to give them, this is their belief system. This is their philosophy. This is their ideology. This is essentially their religion. That's how I kind of look at it.
Absolutely. And this all goes back to when Christianity finally took hold. One of the things that Christians were always professing is that Pan is dead. In other words, they were signaling that all of the old gods are dead. And this new god, and I heard an expression a few weeks ago that said, when you kill off the old gods, then the new religion considers the old gods devils. And so you take that into consideration is that when Christianity took hold, one of the things that they did was kill anybody. They tortured them. They killed them. Anybody that wasn't going to embrace their new god, they would torture them and kill them. I mean, so, and they turned the old gods into devils.
Yeah, and they built their houses of worship, well, the Roman church did, on top of the old pagan religious sites. And that was a way of showing conquest.
Yes.
That they prevailed. So out with the old, in with the new.
And so in 1962, in memoirs, the pagan religion shot back and declared war on Christianity. And those of us who are just sitting there watching this war take place, 99% of the people, it goes right over their heads. They're not understanding that so many corporations, or they have the names of old gods. Those of us who are just kind of sitting back watching this take place, that's exactly what's going on. I heard you talking the other day about the war that's going on in the heavens.
Right.
There is stuff going on, and most of the people are just not paying attention.
Yeah, the other point I want to make too, Sally, is because people jump to conclusions many times, and they'll say, because we're talking about this, we are pro-pagan, anti-Christian. And I just want to make it clear to everybody that we're doing research, and we're trying to understand what the puts and takes are, what's going down. That's what we're doing. So I just want to make sure that's clear. So when we talk about this stuff, we're talking about what the controllers are doing and how they're doing it. So try to keep from having a knee-jerk reaction and going at either myself or Sally about what it is that we believe or what we support or what we agree with or don't agree with, because that is not what this is about. I just want to make that clear. So we're looking at the slide, Driving Rain and Pan, and again, that is not coincidence. So Billy is telling us that he's tied back to Pan, he's tied back to Dionysus, he's tied back to Horus. So all of these mythological beings, and by the way, when we talk about mythology, that does not mean that it's fiction. That's another thing, that's another trap that a lot of people fall into. Because they hear the word mythology, they believe it couldn't possibly have happened.
That it was a myth.
Right. But there is another god, Sally, that you have looked into. And this is a god with one eye, and that would be Odin / Woden?
Woden, yes.
Tell us about Odin and Woden.
Odin was a god that his eye was removed for greater insight. He hung on a tree for 9 days. And this is when you watch the Marvel movies, they show you Anthony Hopkins plays Odin or Woden. I believe the name Woden was first, and then Odin came after. And this is where we get Wednesday from. We have Thursday named after Thor, and Wednesday is named after Woden.
Yes, Wednesday, Woden Day.
Yes.
Right. And I highlighted a couple of the sentences here on this chart, Sally, and it says, Odin was a war god, protector of heroes. Fallen heroes joined him in Valhalla. Odin was a great magician among the gods.
Mm-hmm.
He was also the god of poets, and he had only one eye. The other he gave in exchange, and you mentioned this, for wisdom. And so, again, we go back to mythology, we go back to the one-eyed gods.
And magic.
And magic.
And those little emblems that you have there.
We have the image of Odin / Woden on the right-hand side of the chart, folks. Bottom left is the Woden staff. And if we take a look at the Epiphone logo, the Epiphone guitars, that looks a lot like the staff. And we're going to see a clip later on where Billy is playing an Epiphone guitar, and there's a lot more going on in that clip, and Sally will take us through it. But what's happening is all of these little clues are interwoven into the songs, into the videos. Most people don't see it because they don't understand it. They don't know what they're looking for. But again, once it's pointed out and once you see it, you can't unsee it. So as soon as, Sally, you showed me the Woden staff, I said, well, that's the Epiphone logo that they put on many of their pick guards. Many companies, especially those in the corporate matrix, they're constantly bringing in the mythological and occulted symbols.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's another example, Epiphone. Now let's get into Billy's eye, and we're going to start with a chart that's titled Ocular prosthesis. And this is sourced from Wikipedia. So what I'm going to do, Sally, let me read this and then you can tack on to the narrative here. An ocular prosthesis, artificial eye or glass eye, is a type of craniofacial prosthesis that replaces an absent natural eye. The prosthesis fits over an orbital implant and under the eyelids. Though often referred to as a glass eye, the ocular prosthesis roughly takes the shape of a convex shell and is made of a medical-grade plastic acrylic. A few ocular prostheses today are made of cryolite glass. A variant of the ocular prosthesis is a very thin, hard shell which can be worn over a damaged or eviscerated eye. Makers of ocular prosthetics are known as ocularists. An ocular prosthesis does not provide vision. Someone with an ocular prosthesis is altogether blind on the affected side and has one-sided vision. And so that's what we're talking about with Billy, correct, Sally?
Yes, absolutely. He could, there could be some type of, they could have left something in there and they just damaged the eye so that they could fit something on top of it. But they definitely took his vision away.
Okay.
And they have worked really, really hard to disguise this. If you think about it, the gig would have been up pretty quick if somebody had figured it out, because Paul, the real Paul, did not have this situation. And Horace, being persona that he has taken over, is a one-eyed god.
Right. Well, it's the Eye of Ra, the Eye of Horus. That's where we're going with this, right?
Absolutely.
So, and yep. It will make some sense, folks, in a moment. Now, when you say when they did this to him, is it possible that nobody did this to him, that perhaps it was just an accident when he was younger?
It could very well be, but the fact that it goes right along with everything that we're about to reveal in terms of Odin and...
And the Eye of Horus, right?
Right.
So it leads us to believe, and I agree with Sally, folks, I believe that Billy's loss of eyesight in his right eye has something to do with ritual abuse. Now, could we be wrong? We could be, but that's my leaning. And to the right of the slide, Sally, I show an example of what a prosthetic eye looks like. And I think there's probably a misconception out there that these eyes are round, look like marbles, and you pop them in. But that's not what they're like.
No. There is when they remove the eye, like in my particular case, I was told that I had picked up a parasite, very rare. I mean, they talked about the astronomical odds of me having this. It's just beyond belief. But I picked up a parasite from a cat, and they had to remove the eye to keep it from moving to the other eye and to my brain. And anyway, when they take the eye out, they have to put what is called an implant. And they put the implant in there, they take the eye out, and they make a slit, and they put the implant between your socket and the brain. And it is a little ball that is left inside there. So in just the same way that you take eye contacts and put them on the ball of your eyes, you would do the same thing with an artificial eye. It fits on that implant. It's not a ball. It's shaped like a contact lens.
It's harder than a contact lens, though, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I've dropped mine quite a few times. It's never shattered, so.
Yeah, because it tells us it's medical-grade plastic acrylic, so.
Yeah.
But again, it's not, folks, it's not a big ball or a marble. This is what Billy has in his right eye. Now, I'm going to go to slide number 9. And, Sally, this is the first slide where I have a picture of an older Billy on the left and Vivian Stanshaw from the Bonzos. And the reason why I'm showing this slide, folks, is because it goes back to 2019, 3 years ago, when I did my presentation on McCartney and Stanshaw. And this was one of the slides that I had in the presentation, because I looked at this and I said, this is the same person. The guy on the left just happens to be older. But one of the things that I called out in that presentation was I thought that Billy had a wandering left eye. In other words, it kind of drifted a little bit. And so if we look at this image, you can see in both images, Billy on the left and Stanshaw on the right, If you take a look at the left eye, which is the eye that would be on your right as you're looking at the computer monitor, we could see it drifts. And so I looked at this as a facial characteristic that allowed me to compare Billy as McCartney and Billy as Stanshall, that he had this eye that drifted. But what I didn't realize, it wasn't his left eye that was drifting. His left eye is okay. The issue was the right eye, because the right eye is an ocular prosthetic. It's a glass eye.
Yep.
And that is what Sallie figured out.
Now, but this picture, the one on the left, you see how that lid is really fat. One of the things in the artificial eye world is, you know, they will paint the eye to match the other eye. They sit there and they just meticulously paint it. But then they work it trying to, once they get fitted, they're trying to make it look as much like the other one as possible. But there's something, like I said, in the artificial eye world is that we call it lifting the lid. And if you'll notice that the lid, his eyelid on the right side, is, what, 3 times bigger than the one on the left.
Yes, you're talking about the image of where he's the older McCartney, his right eye, the eye on our left, as we're looking at the image. The eyelid up top is, it looks like it's protruding.
And that's from a hard plastic that's in there as opposed to a soft eyeball.
We don't see it so much on the Stanshall, though. Why would that be?
Because he's younger. Things have a way of deteriorating the older you get.
Okay. And we're going to see this protruding eyelid some more, folks, in an upcoming slide. So what I did next, I did a slide, and Sallie has seen this slide, where I boxed out the right-hand side and then the left-hand side of the images I just showed you of an older Billy and then when he was playing Vivian Stanshall. So if we take a look at the first image, the right eye looks straight ahead. Then when I take that same image and I move the blue box over to the left, and now I'm seeing the left-hand side of his face, we can see that it appears that his left eye is looking to the left. Is that making sense, Sallie?
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, so the first image on the left, folks, let me repeat this. I boxed out the left-hand side of his face, so we see the right-hand side of his face. The right-hand side of his face is where we have the glass eye, and he appears to be looking straight ahead. When I then move the box over and I block out the right-hand side of his face, and we're looking at the left-hand side of his face, that's picture number 2, we could see his eye glancing to the left. If I move over to the third image of Stanshall, it's the same thing. When I block out the left-hand side of Stanshall's face, we can see his right eye is looking straight at us. And then the fourth image, I move the blue box over, I slide it over to the left, and now the right-hand side of Vivian Stanshall's face is blocked out, and we're now looking at the left-hand side of his face. And we can again see that his eye is looking to the left. So where I thought that the left eye was a wandering or drifting eye, no. That's his natural eye. He sees with his left eye. It's the right eye that is the prosthetic.
And when we get to the video, it'll become very, very apparent.
Right. And so this also, folks, becomes evidence that Billy did play Vivian Stanshall of the Bonzos. Because you would have to ask yourself, what are the odds that this would happen? And I would say that those odds are extremely low, that something like this would be a coincidence. All right, so if you want to pause the video at this point, please do so if you want to take a closer look. Now, if I move to slide number 12, I did the same thing with an image that Sallie sent over to me, and she took a screen capture from Billy when he was performing at the Ed Sullivan Theater in 1992, so 30 years ago. So if we look at the far left image, we can see his eyes are wide open, and at first glance, you don't think much about it. You're just looking at it, and it just looks like he's looking to the left. But when I divide up the face, blocked out in image number 2, Billy's left side of his face, which is on our right, and take a look at how his eye is looking again, almost straight ahead. And that is his glass eye. If I then take the same image on the far right and I block off the right-hand side of his face and we're only looking at the left-hand side of his face, that's his natural eye. That's the eye he sees with. See how far to the left it's looking? So compare image two, where the left-hand side of his face is blocked off, with image number three, where the right-hand side of his face is blocked off, and take a look at the eyes. It's the same thing that we had in the previous image with an older Billy and Stanshall. The right eye, the eye he's blind in, is looking straight ahead, while his good eye is looking off to the left. Now, let me take a look at this image here. Now, Sally, you sent this one, and the title of the chart is The Right Eyelid Protrudes. So take us through this again, because you explained this, where the artificial eye tends to make the eyelid pop out or protrude.
Yep.
So again, explain why that happens.
Because you, the real eye, everything just works in there perfect, and the lid, and it's soft. So you have the lid that folds over it and closes and all that kind of stuff. When you have a very, and artificial eyes are very, very hard. It just can't fit in there. You just can't get it completely perfect. And that was my, like I said, my first clue. Because I most of the time just watched interviews with him and I made eye contact and my good eye looked into his good eye. But when I looked over to the other side, I went, man, that reminds me of me. And it was just a matter of time where I picked up that's am I seeing this? I can't
yeah.
believe, you know, so it was, anyway, the lid is, it's going over hard plastic and he does a really good job with blinking. That's another thing that they really have to tweak when they're trying to get your artificial eye to look like the real one is whether or not you there's a balancing act between having it big enough to move around in there, but not too big that your eye can't close all the way.
How does the eye move, Sally? Let me ask that question. So he's got this artificial eye. So how does it move left and right?
That implant that I talked about,
yeah.
It's permanently in your body. When they remove the eye, and in his case, it may be completely different. It may be that thing that we talked about, that it's that they damaged the eye so bad and whatever ritual abuse that they did to him, that this fits over the top of it to make it look real. They you know, if they purposely did it to him, you know, it could be, like I said, one of two things, and the previous description talked about that, is that it could be that they damaged the eye and so this fits on top of the eye. And so the eye still moves around, but it still will drift. There are problems that you can have because it's sitting right on top of this ball inside there. You can get air pockets in it, and we're going to go to the video in a little bit, where his eye is just roaming all over the place. And then he reaches up, and he's trying to be very cool about it, but he reaches up, and he rubs his eye, and all of a sudden the eye stops drifting. You can get air pockets in there, and it starts to shifting all over the place.
So is the artificial eye, how is it attached to the implant? Is it attached?
So when they first removed my eye, they took the eye out, and then, like I said, they made a slit, and they put a ball inside between the socket and the brain, and then they sewed it up. And that's called an implant, and it moves around inside that socket, and it stays there permanently. And then they put the artificial eye, and it fits on that implant that moves around just like the other one. It fits on there just like a eye contact.
So it's connected in a way that the implant will move right or left based
yes.
upon, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and just like I said, there's some stuff that you can zoom in on his eye, and he very easily could have just an extremely damaged eye.
Yeah.
And they've put this on top of the damaged eye.
Right.
To make it look real. But the important thing, if you think about the abuse, the important thing is to remove the vision from that eye. And we'll talk about that in a minute with the quote from Matthew.
Yes. So let's move to the next slide because this is very interesting. So we're going to talk about some subliminal clues. And the first one is, if we look at the Let It Be album and we look at Billy, we can see that his right eye, which is on our left, is shadowed out. So this is the one eye symbolism that we see all the time. We see it on the With the Beatles and Meet the Beatles album as an example, where the faces are shadowed out. But in this case, we've got Billy's right side shadowed out, and that's the eye that he cannot see out of. The other thing I noted once you pointed out the Let It Be album and the shadow effect on Billy's face on the right-hand side is the other Beatles are looking to the right.
Yeah,
so one-eyed symbolism, the Eye of Ra, Eye of Horus. I don't think it's any coincidence that his right eye he cannot see out of, he's blind in his right eye, and the other Beatles are looking to the right.
Yep.
Okay, just an observation on my part. Now, if we move to the next slide, some more subliminal clues. You sent this one over to me where we have Linda looking very intently at Billy. And what did you make of this image?
Talking to the, and my children do this all the time, is that they focus on the eye that can see. They don't make direct eye contact with one eye to another. You will see them looking at my right eye all the time because that's the one that's seeing them. And this is what she is doing. You look at that picture, that is what she is doing. She is communicating with the left eye that sees.
Okay, and what I would like to do is to ask our listeners to get an idea of what this is like. Take your right eye and close it, and then only see with your left eye. And try to look to the right. So if somebody is on the right-hand side of you, and they're speaking to you, you can't see them. Your nose gets in the way.
Yep.
It's fenced off. So what Sally is saying is Linda is speaking to him and ensuring that he can see her because he can only see with his left eye.
Yep.
And then a very, very strange image to the right. And I've had this on my hard drive for the longest time. And I kept it because I was thinking in terms of one-eyed symbolism, which, of course, it does play into that. But those are ocular prosthetics, are they not, Sally?
That's what those are. That's what he's doing. That is a predictive program, if you want to put it that way. Because that's Paul, right?
Well, that's a good question,
isn't
it?
That's a good question. Okay, whoever that guy is, he's showing you predictive programming.
Yeah, he's a person that looks like Paul.
Yeah.
In fact, I think his hair is parted on the wrong side.
Yeah, yeah.
But in any case, this person that looks like Paul McCartney is holding up two glass eyes. Again, what are the chances? What's the probability of that? Another clue for us all. All right, the next slide, slide number 16, some more clues. So here we have a wax of Paul McCartney, and there's the one-eyed symbolism again.
Yes, and they use artificial eyes in those wax images. He's showing you right there.
And then we have the same thing going on, Sally, with the image on the right. We have the Eye of Ra symbolism going on again.
It's right there, folks. It's right there.
Okay, so we're going to show you some video clips. And the first one, Sally found this, and it's a great catch. And we have Billy pointing to himself and then tapping himself when he says Billy Shears. So he's letting us know, again, that he's not Paul McCartney, that he's Billy Shears. And he points to the audience. Now, not only is he pointing to the audience, but I will argue that he's making the grand pontiff pose. And in Freemasonry, pontiff doesn't mean pope. It means bridge builder. So he points, and then he taps himself when he says Billy Shears. Okay, so let's take a listen to this clip. Okay, so that was very interesting, Sally. It was a great catch. You sent that clip over to me. And as we have always said, he's constantly dropping clues and telling people he's not Paul McCartney. Now, the second clip is an interview. I don't know who's interviewing him. You sent this over to me. And this is one where you have a close-up of his eyes, and it becomes obvious that his right eye is kind of floating around a little bit, and at one point he kind of touches his eye, I'm guessing, to kind of reset it and put it back in place. Is that what he's doing?
Yeah. Like I said, sometimes you get an air pocket in there, and just by pressing on it, the air pocket goes out, and then it adjusts because it'll free float from that air in there, and he's reaching up. You know, he's been coached how to do this stuff.
All right, so let me play that clip now. Let me just, in fact, what I'm going to do, folks, is turn the volume down on this clip because the volume doesn't really matter. What we want to do is to focus on his eyes and focus on his right eye. And so, Sally, I'm going to start right now at 1, 2, and 3.
You can take a look at his clearly right eye. See. You can clearly see. There is an edge to that eye. It's probably what we talked about, but it's, you know, setting on something else, whether it's an implant or whether it's a real eye. But you can see it's drifting around. And in a minute, he will reach up and rub that eye. And what that does, there he goes, right there.
So, Sally, again, what was he doing when he touched his eye? Was he just resetting it?
Yeah, you could say that. Sometimes they will get air bubbles underneath there, and when the air bubble gets between the eye and the implant, it will cause the thing to just drift and move around and everything like that. And when a person with an artificial eye is tired, sometimes it won't move as well either. But what he's doing there when he reaches up and rubs his eye is that he removed, he either set it back down on the implant and probably removed an air pocket out of it. And then as soon as he rubs it, you'll notice it starts matching.
Okay, I'm going to play it again. So I'm starting at the 15-second mark so that the audience can take another look at it. And we can see the right eye just, it's drifting.
Yep.
We can really see it at this point here where it basically shoots far right. And then he touches it.
Yep. And it starts moving with the other one. That's what he's doing.
Okay, so the next clip, Sally, is another one you sent over to me. It was Good Morning America, November 1980. And what is it that we're looking for here in this clip?
Well, I mean, when I saw this one, I was like, there's no way I'm imagining this. His eye is just not moving with the other one. He's got the puffy eyelid, and, you know, it's whatever the time difference, they're on the other side of the world, and I think they're in London.
So yeah.
He could be tired. It could be what it is. This is a Good Morning America, so this guy that's interviewing him is early in the morning, and it could be late in the evening for him, and he could just simply be tired. But it's very obvious. Watching the eye move around, it doesn't move as well as the other one. You got the puffy eyelid. It's very, well, once you, just like you said, once you see it, you can't unsee it.
Okay, so I'm going to start at the 53-second mark, Sally. So let me play that now.
Ready?
I just started. Yep, I started the clip. And he's on a television set.
Normal life for your children. How do you do that? I mean, how do you maintain a normal life?
I don't know really. We somehow managed to do it.
Okay, so now they're on him.
Yeah.
We can see the right eye.
Look at the right eye.
Bit.
It is so different than the left. It's moving off in different directions. The eyelid is much fatter than the real eye.
Yep.
We don't do things in a very fancy way. For instance, we haven't got a nanny. And it could be right then and there he's tired. We've got a ridiculously small. My eye does the same thing when I get tired. It doesn't move as well. And so by doing things like that, just not living in
with a big style, it just seems to naturally keep pretty close. Okay, so now it's the Ed Sullivan Theater, 1992. He's singing My Love, and what are we looking for here?
Watch, the left eye is seeing anything, and he is looking up in the audience at people that are in the audience, because after the song, as a matter of fact, you have it on this video where for just a split second as he's looking up in the audience, you'll see him just a tiny bit smile. And after the show, after the song is over with, he points out to the person that he was smiling at and said, I saw you cuddling up. That's what he said. So, in other words, it was a romantic song, and whoever it was reached over and probably grabbed his wife and pulled her close or whatever. But anyway, he acknowledged that. But he's looking up in the audience and watch the left eye. That is the one that is seeing. The other one is just following after it. The reason, if you'll notice that every time he sits at the piano, the microphone stand always comes from the right-hand side. The right-hand side is his blind side. If the microphone stand was on his left side, it would block his vision, because he only sees on that side. So he always has the microphone stand coming from the right-hand side. And in a little bit, we're going to watch video where he has to maneuver around that microphone stand so that he can see the guitar player. It's very, very obvious.
Okay, so let me play this. I'm going to start at 1 minute 53 seconds, Sally. Okay, so I'll play that now. Okay, so he's at the piano now. And like you said, the microphone is positioned near his right eye, or his right side of his face.
The blind side of him.
Yep.
Now, watch the left eye. Watch how he turns his head to be able to see with his left eye. When he goes, whoa, 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 he always lines his left eye up with the microphone. Very subtle, but once you see it.
Yeah, and we can see his right eye. It's drifting a little bit. In other words, it's not perfectly in sync with his left eye.
Yeah. But if you watch it a few times, you'll see that left eye is what is seeing. That left eye is where he's maneuvering it around to be able to see whatever he's looking at. The right eye just follows after it.
I just stopped it now at 3 minutes 17 seconds. And here's another example where the left eye, his good eye, is looking all the way to the left. And the right eye is not quite there.
Yeah.
I started it again.
And if you want to look at it from energy, right, or life force, or soul, the eye is the mirror of the soul. All the energy is coming out of that left side, not the right.
Like we said, once you see it, you cannot unsee it.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Okay. It is amazing. So the next clip now is My Valentine, featuring Natalie Portman and Johnny Depp. And what did you want to say about this? Other than the fact, I noticed right off the bat, we have the one-eyed symbolism, the shadowing effect taking place. Is there anything else that we should know about this?
I think that they're trying to tell you right there in that video. The light is on the left side. What he's seeing is on the left side. I think that because he did it with both of them. And it's his song. So that's just a very subtle clue. They are showing the left eye. They're illuminating the left eye. My Valentine is based upon Remus and Romulus. Goes all the way back to that. And these are gods. And Remus and Romulus were raised by a she-wolf. And this is where Romulus defeated Remus, killed him, and then he founded Rome. And Rome is where we get the Lupercalia, and that's where we get the tradition of Valentine from. Now, the name of the album was called Kisses on the Bottom. And there's a very famous picture of the she-wolf that nursed Remus and Romulus. And the she-wolf is licking them on the bottom to clean them. And I think this is where we get the name Kisses on the Bottom.
Okay.
This goes all the way back to Greek mythology, folks.
Well, I'm going to play the clip now. So I'm going to start at 3 minutes 53 seconds. Let's call it 3 minutes 54 seconds, Sally. Okay, so let me play that now. And again, folks, I'm not going to play the music. That's not what this is about. And we can see the shadowing effect on Natalie Portman. And she actually points to her right eye.
Yeah, yeah.
It's still on Natalie Portman.
Yeah.
And it'll shift over to Johnny Depp soon. And again, folks, notice the shadowing effect on the right eye. This is the same thing we have on the Let It Be album with Billy on the top right of the album cover.
Yep. You know, if we were just watching this without everything else that we have found out, then we would just go, well, this is, you know, they're occult
artistic
shadowing. Yeah. But what we know about William's situation, this is what they're doing.
And also, both of them did the Osiris Risen.
Yes, they did.
Okay, let me just stop it there. So there's a lot going on in that video, as there is with most music videos, but especially videos that Billy puts out. Now, the next one, Sally, is the making of Queenie Eye. And again, we want to take a look at Billy himself. So I'm not going to play any sound, just look at his eyes. There's also a part of the video that I'm going to show you where we see two twins. It's very quick, and I will show it to you, and then I will slow it down. And there's a reason why Billy has twins in the video. And this goes back to Billy and biological Paul. Biological Paul was a Gemini. It's all about the twins. In another video, I explained what the twins mean from an occult perspective. So this is another motif that makes its way into a lot of his work, this whole concept of twins. So, Sally, I'm at 5 minutes, 15 seconds, and Billy's walking into Abbey Road Studios.
Yeah, watch the left eye. When he makes contact with the eye contact with the cameraman. And in the memoirs, he mentions he's the queen on the chessboard.
Yeah, I just stopped it for a moment there. We could see his right eye. Again, it's very good as far as staying in sync most of the time, but it does have a tendency to lag.
Yeah.
And you do see it. Now, what were you saying about Queenie Eye?
Yeah, in memoirs, in the chapter on the Sonic Checkmate, he called himself the queen that continues after the king dies, and Paul is the king. And he can move all over the chessboard. Remember the chapter on the Sonic Checkmate? But he calls himself the queen.
Yeah.
And this is Queenie I, not Queenie Eyes, Queenie I.
One eye.
Yep. Every one of these things are clues.
I've always remembered that, but I like the rhythm. Queenie
Eyes. He's actually pretty brilliant.
I'm sure he's been trained very well.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and he's got people. He's got people, you know, coaching him all the time. He's not doing this by himself. And he's been trained by cameramen. I mean, he's trained cameramen where they need to shoot from any interview. Just about any interview you see him in, it's always from the left side.
Yep. We're at that scene now with the twins. And they're lying on the floor. If we look at the clapperboard, the numbers total to the number 10. 1-0-0-3-5-0-0-1. And of course, 10 is a number that we're seeing more and more now with Billy. It's the number of completion and new beginnings.
Yeah.
So let me, I'm at 6 minutes 47 seconds and I'm going to continue playing.
He looks at me, he goes, Paul, you can sing it. You know,
yeah, that's 647, I don't think is an accident either. Because 6 flipped over is 9, and 4 plus 7 is 11.
Yeah, so that's either 611 or 911.
Yep.
Right, and 611, 6 times 11 is 66. And you know how all that works. Now, the next one is the New World Tour from Mexico 1993, and it's Let It Be. And I think this is the one where he looks over to the guitar player, and you can see that he's looking over and he's making his line of sight with his left eye.
Oh, yeah.
Right? Is that what this is about?
Yep, yep. Watch him navigate that left eye around the microphone stand, trying to be able to see what the guitar player is doing.
So again, folks, what we're looking at here is Billy looking with his left eye to catch his guitar player playing. It looks natural, but just knowing what we know, take a look at how he's positioning his head.
Right. He navigates around that microphone stand.
And then he also takes his hand again and he rubs his right eye. So I'm going to assume, Sally, that that was like the clip we saw before where he was trying to maybe get an air pocket out or reposition his eye.
Right, and it you can very easily see it adjust. You can see it slide over and move into where it's supposed to go after he rubs it. It's very subtle, happens really quick, but watch the eye right after he rubs it. You will see it shift over into place.
Okay, so let's take a look at that now. So I'm at 7:09, 7 minutes, 9 seconds, and I'll just play through. At 3, 2, and 1, play.
Watch the eye. Yep. Okay, watch the hand go up. Now watch him rub his right eye and watch the eye shift.
Yep.
Catch it?
Yep. Okay, so the next clip is a quick one. It's Spies Like Us from 1985. And in this clip, he covers his left eye. It's a real quick clip. And somebody might say, oh, you know, what's the big deal? He just covered his left eye with his hand. But knowing what we know now, he sees with his left eye, his right eye. He's blind in his right eye. It starts to make some sense. So I'm at 7 minutes, 40 seconds, Sally.
I'm right at 7:40, yeah.
Okay, so 3, 2, 1, and play.
Okay. All this stuff that's going on with Spies Like Us and the stupid thing that Chevy Chase does, and then he covers his eye. Now, what he's doing when you see something that you think is ridiculous or you're scared, you would cover both eyes so that you can't see it. He covers the one eye that can see. This is another clue.
Okay, so now we have a tug-of-war clip. It's a very short clip. And what we're looking for here is the moon and Woden symbolism. Now, the moon is important, folks, because the left eye represents the moon.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The right eye, the eye of Ra, is the sun. And so since Billy cannot see out of his right eye, he sees out of his left eye, that's symbolic of the moon. Do I have that right, Sally?
Yep.
And then on his guitar, he's playing an Epiphone. And as we explained earlier, the E in Epiphone, that logo, it looks exactly like Woden's staff. So we've got two things going on there. So we have Woden or Odin, who was a one-eyed god, who gave up one of his eyes in order to have infinite wisdom. And the left eye is representative of the moon, and the right eye is representative of the sun. Billy cannot see out of his right eye, so there is no sun. There is only the moon. So here's another clue. And again, it would just look artistic if we didn't know what we know or what it is that we're figuring out. But let's play that clip now. So, Sally, I'm at 7 minutes, 52 seconds.
Okay.
So, 3, 2, and 1, play.
And there's the moon, and there's the Woden sign on his guitar. Also, in mythology, we learn that Pan was in love with Selene, who was the moon.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, so the last clip we have for you folks is Percy Thrillington. This is an album that Billy did. It was an alias that he used. And this one I will play the audio for, because he says there's a lot more going on than you see. And again, it's another clue. He's telling you that the album and the symbolism on the album is much more than what you think, if you're even thinking about it. Many people aren't even thinking about it. So I'm at 8 minutes, 8 seconds, Sally. Yep, 3, 2, and 1, play.
Percy Thrillington is one of a handful of albums Paul recorded without using the McCartney name and fame.
Percy Thrillington. There's a lot more going on than you see. People don't know. It goes a lot deeper.
A lot like the Ram on the Ram album as well.
Right. And the Ram goes back to Egypt. So again, it's backing into the Egyptian mysteries.
And if you study, really get deep into mythology, Pan is rumored to have had a twin, which is really interesting that they put that twin symbolism in there.
Yeah. Okay, so those are the segments, the little clips that we picked out for everybody. And I hope that it made sense. It made sense to me, Sally, and the clips came from Sally. So thank you so much for sending them over. We talked about Pan, and we're going to talk a lot more about Pan once we get that presentation together with Sally. We talked about Odin, a one-eyed god, who gave up one of his eyes so that he can have wisdom. But ultimately, with my research, and Sally, I think you might agree, with Billy, it goes back to Egypt.
Right.
With Crowley, it goes back to Egypt. So what I'm going to do now is go to a clip that I had in a presentation that I did on Stanshall. And in this clip, this is not Billy playing Vivian Stanshall. This is Victor. Now, as I've mentioned, Victor is an actor and a musician that Billy put on his payroll so that Billy's McCartney and Stanshall character could coexist. In other words, so that he wouldn't run into the Batman and Bruce Wayne predicament, where they were never in the same room at the same time. So this is Victor playing Stanshall, but I want you to pay attention, and I have the captions, to what he says at the end of this clip. So let me play that now.
Do you like riddles? Conan Granza, Hannah Granza, acronyms are teasers, they all are. I'm easy to bend, I begin where I end. I'm soft and I'm pink and I'm shy. I'm legless,
and armless, and hairless and harmless. I'll give you three guesses. Who am I?
They search for the self, the psyche, the soul, the id and alter ego. God loves sheep, and nudis, verdis, per obscurum, obscurius.
The answer is a word. Two guesses left.
Keep them by me. There are some things
I like things. Horace. He donated his head to the family.
Okay, so we see Victor say Horace. He donated his head to the family.
Yep.
When I took a look at this after you discovered that he's blind in one eye, and if this was the result of ritual abuse, which we think it could have been, then we could change this line from the movie, Horace, he donated his eye to the family.
Right.
As part of all of this ritual occult stuff. And I know a lot of people have a hard time getting their arms around all of this occultism and this ritual stuff, but it's there and it exists. And so that leads me to my last slide. What they're doing, and this is spelled out in the 2021 version of Memoirs. Now, Tom just released an update to the book, right, Sally?
Right.
I think it's today.
Yes.
Today's October 20th, 2022. And Tom mentioned that there's going to be more information on the Aeon of Horus. More information that has to do with, well, I should say more encoding that has to do with numbers and gematria. So the book keeps getting, I think, a little more complex, a little more layered, a little more sophisticated as it goes along. But with that, when you decode it, you get a lot more information. You get closer to the truth. What I want to leave you with, folks, is the way this is playing out. Biological Paul was Osiris, and Billy is Horus. And when we put Paul and Billy together, it's the Osiris-Horus ritual. And that is a big piece of what the controllers believe is going to lead to Crowley's Aeon of Horus. And I know for a lot of you, you're probably scratching your head right now, thinking this just sounds crazy. Well, but the thing we have to understand about the controllers is they are deeply, deeply embedded in the Egyptian mysteries. They are deeply embedded in occultism. And Sally, I'm going to give my opinion, and you tell me if you agree or if you don't agree. But I believe what's going on is they are imposing their spiritual belief system, their ideology on the world. And I look at them as Egyptian mystery fundamentalists, religious zealots in a way. And they're playing out events in the world, not just the Beatles and not just with Biological Paul McCartney and Billy, but in all of these psychological operations that we see taking place, all these false flags and so on. They're all embedded with symbolism. They're all embedded with numbers. What are your thoughts?
No, you're absolutely right. Absolutely. They're all connected. The gematria is just that goes all the way back to Babylon.
Yeah.
And how they learned how to take phrases and put them into math. You think about the Bible, there's a book of numbers, and there's also Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, math you. And if you look at that picture that you have, that's the eye that tells you that there's a footnote in Memoirs. That's the right eye, folks.
Exactly.
And if you look at the picture of Horus, first of all, it's a black bird, and that's his left eye that sees.
Right. And look at the similarities between the eye of Horus on the right-hand side on the left eye that we know of as Paul McCartney's eye. And the reason why I have Paul in the middle in the Jesus pose is because the controllers, they are putting the Paul McCartney character forward as a graven Christ figure. They believe this is what's going to lead us into the new one world religion.
Right.
And again, I know it sounds crazy. It sounds crazy to me.
Yeah, his sacrifice was the magic that propelled all of this forward.
Right. And that's what started the ritual, the ceremony, whatever it is that they call it, going back to Egypt between Osiris and Horus. And so biological Paul McCartney has the Osiris role and Billy has the Horus role. And they are looking to, and they would probably argue and say that they have already succeeded in a big part of making the Beatles and specifically Paul McCartney a messiah type of character. And all we need to do is take a look at all the worship all around the Beatles and Paul McCartney, and you can make a case, I think a strong case, that that's exactly what people are doing. The Beatles and Paul McCartney are gods to people.
Right. And the Paulism that he mentions in memoirs is based upon Paul.
Exactly. It's a Luciferian sect. It's based in the tenets of Thelema. I explained in one show, Sallie, that when people say that Luciferianism doesn't have a holy text or it doesn't have a scriptures, if you will, well, it does actually. It's the Book of the Law, Crowley's Book of the Law, and it's the religion of Thelema. That's what I have concluded. I guess we'll conclude with that. I know, folks, it's a little hard to get your head wrapped around, but we will do more work in upcoming presentations to try to make as much sense of it as we possibly can. There's a lot of very, very deep occulted stuff going on, very deep, with the controllers and what's taking place in the world. And the more you understand it, the more you'll have a better understanding of how the world really works.
And maybe not accepting it. If you don't know what you're looking at, it's pretty hard to fight against it.
That's right. If you don't know their signs and symbols, because that's how they communicate. What's the old saying, right? Signs and symbols rule the world, not words or laws. So many people look at words and laws, but they have no knowledge at all. They're ignorant to the signs and symbols, and that puts you at an immediate disadvantage, a very, very significant disadvantage if you don't start to understand some of this stuff. There's one other thing, though. You also sent Matthew 6:22 over. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. And that's from the King James Version. Very interesting. The light of the body is the eye. And if the eye is single, one eye, the whole body shall be full of light.
You know, growing up, my siblings would always say, how did you see that? I go, I don't see double. And they would just laugh. But sometimes you're more aware with one eye. I can't even explain it, but I caught it and nobody else did. You know, as the kid's expression is, takes one to know one, I guess. But I knew what I was looking at. And there is some kind of energy between that man and me. I don't even understand it. Is there one more thing that I can say?
Yeah.
Okay, you gave me several days option of when to do the show, and I specifically picked this day because it's my birthday. I wanted to give a gift to William. We're trying to tell his story, and we're trying to give him his name back before he dies. And that's what I wanted to leave it as.
All right, Sallie. So, again, I want to thank you so much for all the work you've done. And we'll get this out there, and I think it's going to be a shock to so many people. Well, happy birthday.
Thank you so much, Mike.
All right, Sallie, we'll talk soon. Bye-bye now.
see.